like dying together. At another time and another place, I might have brought honor and glory to the House of Hammond. But instead, I shall leave a legacy of decay and unspeakable horror. Hereby record my days on the island of Save. In the year 1870, I was aboard my father's ship, the Clipper Lestrade, bound for the Americas. We encountered what was to prove tragic weather.
Fallon, there. we've been blessed with a bit of salvage of extreme value, Mr. Fallon. Hardly as palatable as food, but I'm sure you'll find it rather exciting.
Yes, crested salad. The crest from the stateroom. It's on all our ships, Captain.
I'm quite familiar with the object. And if you'll be so condescending, we'll put it to a useful purpose.
Might not be any banquet, Mr. Fallon, but tonight it'll seem like one.
I'm not overly fond of fish, Captain. Tomorrow, see if you can find some game. I much prefer meat.
Tomorrow may be better spent in exploration of the island, Mr. Fallon. There may be some life on this island, and if so, we'll be better off for having found it. So, tonight, let's make the best of the fish, huh?
Yes. Yes, of course you're right, Captain. You're quite certain that I'm a bit of an ass, aren't you, Captain?
I don't believe there's a yes or no answer to that, Mr. Fallon. I feel as though you have been bred to a set of standards that don't apply to every situation.
By that you mean our present situation, I suppose.
Our present situation? Yes. However, if you are indeed your father's son, Mr. Fallon, you have a strength which you are totally unaware of. And a strength that will rise up unexpectedly to meet any situation or any challenge.
I knew then that the captain's tolerance of me was due to a deep and sincere respect for my father, and not just because I was the son of an employer. For the first time, I saw in the captain's face that wisdom and dedication peculiar to men who follow the dangers of the sea, but a strength that would crumble under the terror that was so suddenly forced upon us.
Nicely, I think, Matthew. The dogs. They got out last night, didn't they? Speak up, Mantis. You forbid the dogs to get out, didn't you?
Danger! Answer me!
The dogs got out. You fool. You blithering idiot. But you got them back, the dogs. They're all right. There's something you're not telling me. What is it?
No.
I demand to know.
They killed a woman last night.
A woman? How could there be a woman? There is no woman. Where did she come from? Who is she? A woman? Then there may be others. There may be other people here. We've got to find them. Mantis, you find them. You bring them here. They may be pirates. We're in grave danger. Go find them now. There must be a way. There must be some means to keep the devils from my island.
Not likely, my dear Count. Your island was made for devils.
Who is speaking? There's no one here.
Oh, you're quite wrong. I am here.
Where? Where? I can't see you.
Here. Here in the shadows. Look closely.
No. No, you can't see me.
No. No. I can't see you.
Then I'll come a little closer. Can you see me now? Now. That is much better, isn't it? Well, does my appearance frighten you, Count the Sade? Then permit me to enter your dimension. You see, I appear most harmless.
Who? Who are you?
Oh, who I am? It's not important. It's what I am. You see, Your Highness, I am simply a product of your evil, a reflection of your madness. Surely you must recognize me.
No. No. I am not mad. How, therefore, could I know you?
How, then, could you know me? How, indeed, Count de Sade? You could know me by the things I can do. I can do every evil thing you have desired to do unto others.
No. No. I have never wished evil.
You have never wished evil on anyone. Count, recall the incident of the cobra. You thought it a convenient way to do in poor old Lord Balthrop. But you couldn't find the cobra, remember? All you had to do was ask me. It's really very simple. You see, there, on the table beside you.
No!
No. You're not impressed, then? Well, you and I have many more, don't we? Yes, we have many more. Many, many more, don't we? Well, another time then. Obviously, His Highness is not amused. Now, do you still insist you're not mad? Perhaps it's the wine. Perhaps the wine is drugged.
Yes. The wine has been drugged. Now, please go away.
Since I am part of you,
You have only to command me. However, I think it only fitting and proper that I leave a calling card. My calling card, a remembrance that you and I are always this close, is your mind.
This way. Mr. Fallon!
Look, Mr. Fallon. It's part of a woman's dress.
Thank you.
potion. The pain was most severe.
You what?
You're quite safe now. For in the castle of Count Lorente de Sade, there will be time enough for your questions. It is important only to know that your friend will recover and that nourishment awaits you. If your strength will permit, the Count requests your presence for the evening meal.
I am grateful. The captain is lying on a very cold floor. In his condition, pneumonia could surely occur. You must have accommodation.
I said your friend would recover, sir. The Count has seen fit to offer lodging and refuge. I'm not in a position to question the extent of his hospitality. If you desire to put the captain in your bed, by all means do so. I was sent to announce that the Count has elected to share his evening fare with you, an obligation I have now discharged. If you wish to show your lack of gratitude by refusing, then I'll relay your indiscretion.
I most certainly want to meet the Count. If you'll permit me a moment.
Captain.
Conversation during repast.
You may tell the Count he can damn well go to hell.
No, it's all right, Cassandra. apologies, sir. I beg you, forgive me. We are not used to guests, and our countenance of standard has been somewhat blunted by our prolonged solitude, I'm afraid. Please forgive me.
I understand. Reciprocal apologies are in order. I am indeed in your service. I am Aaron Fallon of the House of Fallon of Bath.
Bath? Oh. Too bad. The Romans knew a good spot. Even if the English don't. But I'm afraid Bath is losing its social importance nowadays. Too bad. Too bad.
I remember the Count settled into a depressing silence. He made no further effort at conversation. Some strange compassion to analyze my host. But all but a few salient and frightening clues eluded me. His face bore the sallow pallor of a lifetime of dissipation. And his eyes held that familiar paranoid glint of royal inbreeding that left no doubt. Yes, my host was quite mad. And Cassandra. Only a portion of the racking torture of her inner torment. This observation of unhappiness and despair was verified by the event that was so soon to follow.
I feel ill. May I be excused, Your Lordship?
No. You may not be excused. Tonight we have a guest, Cassandra. Tonight, it will be like the days when the Countess was alive. There will be talk. An exchange of personalities. Don't you find that refreshing, Cassandra? Tonight you can put your trivial babbling to one side and Mr. Fallon will talk. We'll listen to Mr. Fallon. Well?
I'm afraid that my ordeal has left me seriously taxed. I prefer that the delight of a lengthy conversation should not be tainted by my unfortunate weakness. Tomorrow, I shall see renewed strength. And I will eagerly await and be honored with an audience by so noble a person as yourself.
Yes. Of course. Tomorrow.
Get quite drafty at night.
Cassandra, it isn't necessary for you to show me to my room. I can find it all right.
I must, Mr. Fallon. The Count is sick.
I can't make it. Good night, Cassandra. And thank you.
But, Mr. Fallon...
Good night, Cassandra.
Secondly, the Count would not tolerate your being in this chapel. It's very sacred to him. He will not have it violated.
Captain is not in his room. Where he should be, there is blood. I think he's been killed.
Do you think I did it?
Certainly not.
Then take your hands off me.
I have some fever of that, I'm sure. I'm not given to hallucinations, and the blood was fresh.
The captain's injuries were extensive. They may have reopened when he was moved to more suitable quarters. You did request that, did you not, Mr. Fallon?
Yes. I'm overwrought, obviously.
We're tragically short of medicines here, Mr. Fallon. But on occasion of emotional strain, I sometimes find the ocean air quite invigorating. May I suggest the balcony? This light. He was almost attractive. As it is, it's almost frightening.
There are many things about this island that are frightening. And I think this castle most of all. Frankly, I shall be most happy when I've sailed and left it far behind.
Fears have a way of diminishing with time. I think you'll find that's true, Mr. Fallon.
Theories I have no intention of testing, Cassandra. When does the next boat arrive?
Boat? There are no boats, Mr. Fallon. We're in exile, sir. We've been severed from humanity. We're a cancer. We've been cut out.
I don't understand.
I know you don't. The truth is dark enough without learning about it at night. Tomorrow will be soon enough. Good night, Mr. Fallon.
It was inconceivable that no ships came to this island. I felt that Cassandra was trying to add to my uneasiness. That she was closer to the Count than she appeared. That she was a part of his evil.
Very fast. Anne, why did you try to kill me? See, she's dying already. As you would have me die.
Why don't you die? It was poison. It was. I know I'm right. The Count's never wrong. I know he's a pirate.
The event I witnessed last night was not my imagination, but a very real happening. I saw a young woman being beaten. And when I tried to assist, I found my door bolted from the outside. I was locked in, unable to help. I will accept none other than a truthful answer from you.
Farewell, Mr. Fallon. Since you've become a member of the Castle Desaid, I'm sure you have every right to know its secrets.
Thank you.
The story would begin with this portrait, I suppose. She was a beautiful woman, the Countess, and much loved by her husband. So much so that he insisted on marrying her, even when he learned of her terrible illness.
There's no illness in the portrait.
You're quite wrong, Mr. Fallon. It was there. The faint beginning traces may have escaped the artist, but not the physicians. You see, Mr. Fallon, the Countess was a leper.
Oh, my God, no.
It was necessary that she be exiled. The Count was determined they should not be separated. So he came to this island, bought this castle. It should have been a story of love and dedication and sacrifice. But I'm afraid just the opposite was true.
I can almost guess the rest. The Countess died very early, and the Count was forced to continue his exile because of his contact with her.
That would have been endurable, at least, Mr. Fallon. No, it was much worse than that. The Countess did not die. She went insane. And in her madness, there was only one moment that she chose to relive. Her wedding night. Day after day, wearing her wedding gown, reliving her marriage. Eventually, it was necessary to lock her away.
Are you saying the Countess is not dead?
Yes. The Countess is not dead.
And where the devil is she?
In the dungeon. By now, the disease is quite advanced. Rather than face what she's become, the Count prefers to think of her as dead.
This is most tragic. This explains the reasoning why the Count is a little deranged.
Worse than that. He's insane. Criminally so.
Thank you. How are you involved in this?
I matter very little, Mr. Fallon. I'm in the service of the Count as payment of my father's debt. I was a nurse. Now I'm not much of anything. I try to give some comfort to the Countess, but it's extremely difficult. For the girl you saw being beaten, her name is Anne. She was the hostage of pirates who once attempted a raid on this castle. She was mutilated and abused. She was left a mute. She's known brutality all her young life. First the pirates, now the Count. Repeatedly accuses her of trying to poison him. Her punishments are cruelly severe. He'll kill her someday. I'm not very reassuring, am I, Mr. Fallon?
I cannot solve the problem until I know what it is. exists. And a Nubian.
His name is Mantis. He's been a slave for many years. At one time, the Count was a great hunter, and Mantis was his gun bearer. He's completely loyal, and the only thing resembling normalcy in this castle. The Count is deathly afraid of pirates. He's rigged the entire island with all manner of traps.
Yes, I was caught in one. Which leaves one last question. What of the captain?
I permitted myself to lie last night. I don't know where the captain is. It's unlikely, however, that he's been moved to another room.
Could they have killed him?
The Count has come to believe that all sailors are pirates. Yes, they could have killed him.
There must be a way to leave this place. Signal a ship, or there must be.
It's all right, Anne. He's a guest. Tea has a way of bringing things into proper perspective, Mr. Fallon.
Beyond the swelling of bruises and the scars of the Count's mistreatment. It was obvious the child bordered on screaming hysterics. I had meant only to reach for the cup, but my movement came with more suddenness than I had intended.
So, you have embarrassed our guest, then.
Count, it was not intentional. I have suffered no injury. Please, I implore you, do not punish the girl.
Since you have intervened, I will not be so discourteous as to override the wishes of a guest, Mr. Fallon. Hold a firm hand to domestics these days. They're getting disturbingly lax and independent. Moreover, it is not proper that a Count be left waiting for his cup of tea.
You may have mine, Your Lordship.
Yes, of course. But it might be too sweet. You know how you indulge yourself, Cassandra.
I'm sure it's to your liking.
And now, Mr. Fallon, I was promised a conversation, and I intend to have it. Tell me about England, about the Americas, or any subject you choose. It'll be good to hear a new voice.
Yes, I do have a subject. The captain of my ship. I demand to know where he is.
Creature with a beard. Oh, yes. Mr. Fallon, I'm grieved to bring you some good tidings, but the poor man died last night. Now, let's talk about England.
How did he die, Count de Saved?
Death is not a pleasant subject to discuss so early in the morning, and I did want our meeting to be pleasant. In fact, I demand that our meeting be pleasant.
Please, Mr. Fallon, this can come to no good end. Another time. Please.
Very well. You shall not mention the captain. But let me assure you, I intend to know his fate. I will know how my friend died.
Mr. Fallon, I'm grieved to think that you should entertain the notion that I had contributed to your friend's untimely demise. Quite the contrary. I did everything I could to save the unfortunate creature.
Why? God's sake, let me have some water. Please help me. These binds are cutting my wrist off. Loosen them.
I can't loosen them, sailor. I can only do what I'm told.
What kind of an animal are you to torture another human to death?
I am not an animal, mister. I'm a man. A man loyal to his master.
Your master is a damned butcher.
But he's my master, and I do what he says.
Even to kill me?
If the count says so, yes.
Thank you.
you would set the fire at first. Good. That leaves the place on the rack. See? The gods are already with me. The pirate's dead. Mantis, make sure that man is dead.
Let me in.
Thought you were Anne. She was here a little while ago.
Please, Mr. Fowler, let me talk. You must have noticed that we have supplies that could only have been brought in by ship. The tea, for example. The Count's tobacco.
You said there were no ships.
I've never seen them. I suspect the supplies are left on the beach somewhere. I've checked. Our larder is presently low. That means that any day or week now, a ship may come.
Yes, it's possible. We could signal her some way.
No, it's not possible, Mr. Fallon. Not so long as the Count is alive.
What are you suggesting?
I'm not suggesting anything. I'm merely saying that if there is an avenue of escape, it's being blocked by the Count.
Cassandra, I'm not capable of murder.
Murder is not a word to be applied to self-preservation, Mr. Fallon. I'd never thought myself capable of killing either. I'd condemn myself to whatever fate befell me. I'd almost forgotten that another world existed. But it does, and I want to be a part of it again. Is that too much to ask?
Right or wrong are relative things, Cassandra. No. What you ask is not too much. I am asking the same thing. So we have a bond together. You and I.
So, Bridget Cassandra has taken a lover. You have denied me, yet you have taken that boy. Mr. Fallon. You have defiled my hospitality. I have given you refuge and you have become a thief in my house. Mantis, take them to the chapel.
Anna,
don't have the key. I don't have the key. I'll be back.
Never really understood. You have never known how much I have suffered. To have a loved one locked away in the darkness, to rot in the underworld. But you shall. Mr. Fallon shall be locked away, as my love has been. And together, you and I, we will mourn them. We will banish.
This is your day of reckoning, Your Highness.
Maddox, stop him!
I told you that I would kill you, Sailor.
Glorious, a glorious victory, Maddox. And now you, Mr. Fallon. Make him do as I say, Maddox. Show him the sarcophagus. The poor fellow lying there on the dungeon floor. Chain him over there. Been exiled to a whole island, but you have only this room. You and the Countess. Behind that door, Mr. Fallon. She thinks it's her bridal chamber. And in a way, it's yours also. Goodbye, Mr. Fallon. Come, Mantis.
As if I had been buried alive. At first, the silence was deafening. But the dungeon had a voice all its own. Timid little sounds that came from the shadows. They swelled to a tumultuous throng. I closed my eyes and listened to a symphony of the black mass. But suddenly, I was aware of another sound. A noise that had no place in this concert from the tomb. Through the opening. My imagination. imagination would not permit me to visualize what face belonged to that dead arm. But as the Count had said, it seemed that fate was destined to spare me nothing.
And you have to wait no longer. You're still shy, my husband. I'll remove my veil so that nothing is between us. Hunger for the kiss of your love.
I find it very commendable that you're able to perform your duties as a nurse, Cassandra. I had rather expected to find you in some corner bemoaning your lost love.
Serious, Mantis. Use it as little as possible.
Yes, that's right, Mantis. Use it as little as possible. But first, we must get rid of that pirate. We can't leave him here, can we? No, of course not. Come, Mantis. Drag him out. This whole unsavory business is becoming quite unsightly to me.
No one to take care of her. I couldn't let her suffer. We must hurry, Fallon. Now is the time to escape. Oh, Fallon. Her hair. Fallon must have been horrible.
I came very close to becoming a permanent occupant of this dungeon, Cassandra. In fact, I'm not certain that I haven't crossed that thin line that separates the sanities.
It's not so, Fallon. Now there's hope. Now is our chance to escape. Let's take it.
Hurry, Fallon. There's little time.
Until tomorrow morning. We have an adequate head start.
You're wrong, Fallon. Search will begin tonight. Can you hear them? Got the dog.
Our scent. They're headed this way. Quickly. We can cross the stream. Maybe we can throw them off.
Thank you. You've let the dogs go. Get up! Get up!
I can't.
Come back! Come back! Get up, I command you!
I can't. I can't move anymore.
Very well. Since you defy me, I have no further use for you.
I always do what you say, even that.
Come, let's don't miss it. Come, come.
My chest was bursting with excitement. In the thrill of the moment, I had given no thought to Cassandra's sudden change of attitude.
Get back to the boat, man. They're leopards.
Haven't you noticed, Fallon? The color of my skin? The color of your own?
How long have you known Cassandra?
The first traces were months ago, Fallon. I'm sorry.
Stop. How did we ever go this far? You touched my hand and started the car.